slave that is being paid by the creator in relation to the provisions under the tax called relative value of the tax. This might be beyond the coverage of the 2021 war exam. And I make it imperative to mention it for whatever reason. The creator that amend certain provisions under the VAT, and one of which is section 1091R. Dati na to, section 1091R, on the sale, importation, printing, and publication of books and other reading materials. However, what create law provides is it now include digital and electronic format of these books and other reading materials. Right. What else? Section 1091AA, right? On the sale and importation of prescription drugs and medicines for diabetes, high cholesterol, and hypertension shall be effective January 1, 2020. But for cancer, mental illness, tuberculosis, and kidney diseases, the CREATE law has changed the effectivity thereof from January 1, 2023 to January 1, 2021. Right? So it's now effective January 21, 2021. And the last one, of course, is the sale, the temporary but exemption of certain of sale and importation of certain items relative to COVID-19. Temporary in the sense that the effectivity of the but exemption is only up to January 1, 2021. From January 1, 2021 to December 31, 2023. So does this mean may ECQ pa tayo hanggang 2023? Hindi naman siguro, right? Let's hope and pray that everything will be fine, lalo na during the bar exam. And what else? This sale or importation of items relative to COVID-19 was included as section 1091DD. Tapos nag-adjust accordingly for section 1CC. It's now the same. It is now when the annual gross receipt or gross sale of the taxpayer is below the VAT threshold of 3 million. That's already 1CC, right? Section 1091CC. Next, balikan natin yung ito. Just to make things clear, the sale of real properties under section 109B, what are the transactions that are exempt from VAT in relation to the sale of real property? Starting January 1, 2021, only the following three transactions. Pero binanggit na rin natin these items before. I just want to emphasize, right, that housing, real properties utilized for low-cost housing was already rebuilt starting January 2021. It's no longer subject to VAT. It's exempt from. It's already subject to VAT. It's no longer included in the VAT exemption. However, pwede siyang ma-exempt from VAT if it shall fall under number 3. So even if it's a real property utilized for low-cost housing, but the real property is house and lot, right? House and lot, and the selling price is less than the threshold of 2 million, then still VAT exempt. Not because it is a real sale of real property utilized for low-cost housing, but because of the sale of real property of a house, residential house and lot below the VAT threshold. Clear? Are we clear on that? Next, based on the trade law, R810-963, the VAT threshold for sale of residential house and lot and other residential dwellings, 2 million. But based on the webinar that I have attended, webinars, BIR webinar involving the amendments introduced by the creator. The 2000 VAT threshold for sale. Yes? Ayun mo lang. Ayun pa lang. Kanino? Mr. Embreo? Class, pamute na lang, please. Please. Sayang yung oras natin. Okay? But again, but for sale of residential house and other residential dwelling, the same should be, although the train load provides for 2 million, the same shall be adjusted also based on the 2011 consumer price index. 2010, sorry, it's 2010 price index as adjusted in 2011. And according to the BIR, these 2 million should be adjusted. And therefore, it should be 2,599,300. Clear. Using the adjustment, using the consumer price index in 2010. Clear. Using the adjustment, using the consumer price index in 2010. Clear? Are we clear on this? Pero before January 1, 2021, right? Hindi natin alam yung magiging coverage ng bar kasi it was, since it was postponed, I think, yeah, just then. Just take note, before January 1, 2021, meron pa yung residential lot. Right? It's still covered by the VAT exemption. Residential lot valued at
1,999,200.
Tapo? Tapo mo tayo, mama mo. Clear? Are we clear on this? Question? Question, class? Okay, next. Waiver of VAT exemption. What's this waiver of VAT exemption? Did we discuss waiver of VAT exemption, Mr. Minas? Tapos na tayo?
Sir, na-discuss nung na po siya last year.
So, Sarah, hindi pa daw. Not yet?
Not yet, probably.
Not yet. What's the waiver of VAT exemption? Section 109.2 of the tax code. If the taxpayer will enter into transactions that are exempt, as provided for under Section 109.1, the taxpayer may hope to waive the VAT exemption and register as a VAT person and pay VAT to their own. But take note that once the option has been made, it shall be irrevocable for 3 years, for a period of 3 years counted from the quarter when the election was made, except of course with respect to franchise grantees on radio and TV broadcasting. Once the option has been made, it shall be perpetually irrevocable. Example, I am engaged in the business of bigasan. Am I VAT exempt? Yes, Section 109.1A, sale of agricultural product in its original state. But I may hope to waive my VAT exemption. In which case, I will register as a VAT and pay VAT due on this sale of bigas. What else? I am engaged in the sale of gadgets. My annual gross receipt for the last 12 months is only 2 million. Am I required under the law to register as VAT? No, because my annual output is below the 3 million VAT threshold. But, right, but I may waive that VAT exemption by registering as a VAT registered person and pay VAT to the money. Are we clear on this? Are we clear on this? Okay, next. Creditable input tax. Under the tax credit method, we discussed before that the tax liability of taxpayer shall be computed by deducting the input tax from the output tax, and the differential be the VAT liability. In case input tax is higher than the output tax, the excess may be carried over to the succeeding quarter or quarters, or may be claimed for refund or tax credit if allowed under the law. So I want to emphasize that the input tax is not limited only it's not limited only to VAT on purchases or importation. There are other sources of creditable input tax, and these are transitional input tax and presumptive input tax, or what I call TIP and PIP. TIP and PIP. transitional input tax. Possible ba rin some question, distinguish it from
it.
Transitional input tax is available tax credit, VAT credit, to taxpayers who become VAT registered upon exceeding the annual threshold, or who voluntary register even if their turnover does not exceed the annual threshold. Example, I am engaged in the practice of my profession as a lawyer. Right? I am not a VAT registered person. For the past 12 months, last year, my annual gross receipt is not more than, is not 3 million. Right? Right? For 2021, January 1 to March 31, nakachamba ako, mayroon akong isang transaction where I earned 5 million. My annual gross receipt now is more than, my cumulative receipt now is more than the VAT threshold. In this time, I am now required to register under the law as a VAT person. Right? So there is a transition from my non-VAT status to VAT registered status. What else? Assuming, okay lang din, my cumulative from January 1 to March 31, 2021, my cumulative receipt is only 500,000 pesos. I'm still not required under the law to register as VAT. Right? Because, but I decided to change my registration. I voluntarily registered as a VAT person and changed my registration from non-VAT to VAT. Right? There is also a transition from non-VAT to VAT. In this case, starting the next quarter, April 1, right? I shall now be paying VAT. Right? VAT. And in order to ease or to lessen the impact of the sudden diminution of my income because of the change of business tax from the 12% from the 3% percentage tax to 12% VAT, I am afforded by the law a tax credit, a transitional input tax credit, which is deductible against my output tax from the time now that I start to become liable for the payment of VAT after changing my status from VAT, from non-VAT to VAT. And the rate is 2% of the value of the beginning inventory on hand or actual VAT pay, whichever is higher. Clear? Are we clear on this? Next, what how about this PIT? PIT or presumptive input tax. This is also a creditable input tax against the output tax. And it is available to persons or firms engaged in the processing of sardines, mackerel, milk, and in manufacturing of refined sugar, cooking oil. Ms. Susara, what can you notice about these articles? Sardines, mackerel, milk,
parang ano siya?
Refined
basic
commodities. Sugar, cooking oil.
They are all processed.
All processed. Ang nanonotice ko to, these items are items which are normally consumed by us, kami, na low-income household earner. Right? Sardinas, mackerel, milk, sugar, cooking oil. Second, what is more important is this. If you look at this, the primary inputs, what are the primary inputs in the processing and the manufacture of these items? Yung sardinas, ano, isda, di ba? Mackerel, isda din, milk. Sa ano, sa kalabaw, sa bakal. What else? Refined sugar, sa raw sugar. Cooking oil, sa... So then, depende, it's a coconut oil, whatever. Right? So they are all, what? Agricultural or marine food products. Those are the primary inputs. Ngayon, if the said processor and manufacturer of these items, when they purchase these raw materials, primary inputs, will they be paying any VAT? Wala, kasi normally, it's zero. It's VAT exempt for 1201A, yung diniscuss natin. Agri-sale and importation of agricultural and marine food products in their original state. But when this processor and manufacturer will sell all these items to the general public, to the consumer, it's subject to VAT. So meron silang 12% output tax, pero konti ang kanilang input tax because their primary input is exempt from VAT. Right? Now, in order to make these items affordable for us, sa amin, ang mga low-income household earner, right? The law grants or provides a benefit of this presumptive input tax as a deduction or as a credit against the output tax of these manufacturers and processors. Are we clear? Are we clear on that? And the rate is 4 years. Are we clear on that? And the rate is 4% of the gross value in money of purchases of primary agricultural products, which are used as inputs. In the production of these items. Clear? Okay. The provision under section 111 is exclusive, so it pertains only to sardines, mackerel, milk, refined sugar, cooking oil. Take note that yung pack noodle-based instant meals that was already repealed by RA 9337. Clear? Are we clear on this? Okay, next slide. Tax refund of unutilized input VAT. Favorite bar exam question. There's always a question involving the 1112. Right? The 2019, although I still included itong slide na to, itong topic na to. Although ang alam ko dati at that time, it shall no longer be given in the bar exam because of the amendment introduced by the train law. Pero binigay pa rin. So at least, so dapat, I think we need to know 112. Right? Section 1112, we have two persons who are entitled to file a claim for VAT refund. Let's start with number 2.
VAT registered person.
Kasi favorite yung 1. Number 2 muna. Number 2, a VAT registered person whose registration has been cancelled. VAT registration has been cancelled by reason of retirement or cessation of business or to change of status from VAT to non-VAT. Right? VAT to non-VAT. If the status has already been changed or the VAT registration has already been cancelled, hindi mo na siya pwede right? Because in the next subsequent quarter, the taxpayer is no longer a VAT registered person. He is no longer liable for 12% output VAT on sales. So, yung unutilized input VAT at that time, it can no longer be carried over. Right? So, that's why the taxpayer is granted the right, the option to claim now for refund. Did you get the right, the option to claim now for refund? Did you get that, Vas? Did you get that, Vas? Did you get that? Naintindihan? Hands up, please. But the claim for refund must be filed within 2 years from the date of the cancellation of the VAT registration. Next, number one, which is your favorite provision under section 112? Right? This is what we call the VAT refund of unutilized input VAT arising from zero-rated or effectively zero-rated transactions. Unutilized input VAT arising from zero-rated or effectively zero-rated transaction. But the taxpayer, VAT registered person, will end, assuming that VAT, the VAT registered taxpayer's transaction or yes, business transaction is limited or mainly or solely zero-rated transactions. So pagbenta niya, zero-rated. So no output liability. But when this VAT registered person purchases goods and services from suppliers, merong ipapasa sa kanyang VAT, right? Yes. So may input VAT siya, pero siya wala siyang output tax. So taas lang yung input VAT niya. So the law, yes. So may input VAT siya, pero siya wala siyang output tax. So taas lang yung input VAT niya. So the law awarded this taxpayer the right to claim, to carry over, or to claim for refund. Claim to carry over or to claim for refund. Right? Refund of unutilized input but arising from the zero-rated or effectively zero-rated transaction. And what are, in relation to this provision, section 112A, what are the steps? First, a claim for refund must be filed with the court, with the CIR, right? And this is what we call the administrative claim for refund, right? A written claim filed with the PIR. and it must be filed within 2 years. And the 2 year period is applicable only to administrative claim and not to the judicial claim, which means that for as long as the administrative claim has been filed within the 2 year period, even if the subsequent judicial claim is filed beyond the 2 year period, then the claim is still timely. Are we clear on that? Are we clear on that? Now, next, what is the reckoning date of the 2 year period? The reckoning date is the close of the taxable quarter where the relevant sale is made. Ito yung tanong. Kahit memorize mo yan, kung hindi mo alam to. Okay, let's check. Ms. Susara. Close of the first taxable quarter. What is the close of the first taxable quarter?
March, sir.
Wrong. That's wrong. Diba? It should be taxable.
April.
It's not March. It should be last March.
31.
Okay. Mali yung March, ha? It should be March 31. So, doon ka magbibilang ng 2 years. Are we clear on that? How about second quarter?
That's June 30, sir.
Yes, then third quarter?
December 30, sir.
Yes, ganun din mo. Di ba may ganyan din ang tayo dyan? December, and the fourth quarter is?
December 31.
But is that clear? Did we get that? Did we get that? Okay, next. That's the proper reckoning date. There is an exemption to that reckoning date.
Okay.
If the administrative claim has been filed from June 8, 2007 to December 12, September 12, 2008. The reckoning date is from the filing of the return and payment. Pero malayo na tayo dito, right? 2008, nasa 2021 na tayo. So I think it would be unfair if the question in the 2021 bar will still be an application of exception. Pero maganda rin kasi that sa atin, alam natin. Right? Alam natin. So that's our edge against Ariel examinees, right? Examinees. But just take note of this. Clear. Now, in the bar exam, right, you've noticed this. If the set of facts provides for filing of tax return on a quarterly basis, then you address it on a quarterly basis. Because the computation of VAT liabilities on a quarterly basis, right? But if that's the question does not provide for facts relevant to the quarterly filing, you apply it, you answer it on an annual basis. Pero mostly yung bar exam questions involve quarterly filing of value added tax. Clear? Are we good on this? Next. The second part is an amendment introduced by the trade law. After the filing of the administrative claim, which must be filed within the 2 year period as we have discussed, the BIR has how many days? 90 days na. Hindi na siya 120 days. The CIR has 90 days within which to resolve the claim for refund. Right? And it shall be reckoned from the date of submission of the official receipts or invoices and other documents in support of the application. And another amendment is, in case the CIR decided to deny the refund, either in whole or in part, it is mandatory that the denial must state the facts and the law upon which the same is based. Right? Which the same is based. That's the one of another amendment introduced with the. So after, if the CIR grants the refund, di hayang-hayang buhay, tax credit certificate or cash refund. Right? But if it denies, it must state the factor and the basis. Now, what is the remedy of the taxpayer if the BIR will fail to act or shall not act within the 90-day period? Right? What's the remedy? What is the remedy in case of inaction? The BIR failed to act within the 90-day period. Listen, the train law has already repealed the concept of deep denial. Wala na tayong deep denial expressly repealed by the train law. Ano ba yung deep denial? Under the old rule, if the BIR will not... Ano ba yung deep denial? Under the old rule, if the VIR will not resolve within the 120-day period before, 120-day period, that is still denied. Accordingly, it is mandatory for the taxpayer to file a judicial appeal within 30 days from the lapse of the 120-day period. Right? But in under the trade law, hindi na, wala nang been denied. What is the remedy of the taxpayer? The law did not provide for an option to appeal within 30 days from the lapse of 90-day period. Ang nagpagulo si RR 26-2018. Anong sabi niya? In the event that the 90-day period has already lapsed without having the refund released to the taxpayer, the VAT refund claim may still continue to be processed administratively. So does this mean that the taxpayer, after the lapse of the 90 days, has no remedy but to await for the VIR to issue a resolution, then within 30 days from the receipt thereof, appeal to the Court of Tax Appeals? Di natin na lang. Right? What's right? That does not provided by the regulation. And we have no case yet at this point. Right? Involving this amendment introduced by RA 10960. But to my mind, the better resolution, the better remedy is, of course, the taxpayer should be given an opportunity, an option rather, to elevate this from the lapse of the 90-day period. Right? Otherwise, the taxpayer will be at the mercy of the VIR. Mag-aantay ka lang. Nangangakalakan. Atayin mo na mag-decide si VIR. So the taxpayer should be your option. But as I have said, it's not provided for under regulation. We have no case yet. But you can always argue that way. Right? But the point is, under RR 26-2018, even if no resolution has been made within the 90-day period, the claim for refund may still be processed administratively. The only consequence, ito yung pwede mong gawin. Right? You can file a complaint against the hearing official or employee. Because under the law, failure on the part of this official or agent or employee of the VIR to act within the 90-day period shall be punishable under Section 269 of the Constitution. But the good thing is, in the bar exam, the issue is most of the issues is the premature filing. What's this premature filing? If the taxpayer filed an appeal with the Court of Tax Appeals without waiting for the lapse of the 90-day period, 120 and now 90-day period, this is a case of non-exhaustion of administrative remedies. Right? This is a premature filing and tantamount to non-exhaustion of remedies, administrative remedies, which shall result to the dismissal of the judicial claim because the CTA has no jurisdiction. And the court has consistently applied that rule to VAT refund. Clear? Are we clear on this? Mariwana? Okay, let's take
a question, sir.
Yes. Ocampo?
Mr. Ocampo's question.
Mr. Ocampo?
Regarding the 90-day period which will lapse. Yes, sir. I am asking the question. Regarding the 90-day period which will lapse, you believe you were suggesting that after 30 days, we can file, we can elevate the case.
Yes.
To which do we elevate it to the CTA? Do we elevate it to the because it is not provided for under the rules, but we may still elevate this. Only a matter of suggestion, sir, because it is not provided for.
That is in judicial remedies, jurisdiction of the Court of Tax Appeals.
We don't need to appeal to the Secretary of Finance anymore.
Again, that was, we will be discussing that remedy, it's a judicial remedy.
Thank you, sir.
We'll be discussing the CTA law RA 1125 as amended by RA 9282 providing for the jurisdiction of the Court of Tax Appeals. What are the cases? This provision, this law, supplements the provision of Section 4 of the Tax Code. Right? Tax Code. We will be discussing those provisions here. Right? But at this point, ito yung take on this. This is my take on this amendment in the legislative code. Clear? We clear on this class. Okay, next. Okay, let's have an example. Ms. Susara, please read.
PPI is engaged in the business of power generation and subsequent sale thereof and is registered with the Bureau of Internal Revenue as a value-added taxpayer. It filed an administrative claim refund of its unutilized input ban attributable to its zero-rated sales of power generation services on 30 March 2019 for taxable year 2018. The CIR has not ruled upon PPI's administrative claim. Thus, it filed a petition for review to suspend the running of the two-year prescriptive period, the following judicial claim for refund. Period covered, first quarter of 2018, date filed, 31 March 2019. Second quarter of 2018, date filed, 30 May 2019. Third and fourth quarters of 2018, date filed, 15 July 2019.
But the question is the claim for refund timely filed, right? Mm-hmm. The question here. Let's try to analyze this question. When was the administrative claim filed?
1 year after the taxable claim.
It was for the first quarter of 2018.
Administrative claim.
Okay.
Right, sabi niya, it filed an administrative claim for refund or unutilized on March 30, 2019. And it covers the entire taxable year.
Okay.
Right, this is the administrative claim, the written claim. Now, the first issue is, was this filed within the two-year period? Yan yung una mong titignan, right? Was this filed within the two-year period? So, this is 2018, it's na quarterized, siya per quarter, right? 2018, yes, at the latest, December 31, 2018. 2 years from December 31, 2018 is?
December 31, 2020.
But the administrative claim was filed on March 30, 2019. Was it filed within the 2 year period?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Accordingly, that's your first answer. The administrative claim was filed within 2 year prescriptive period. The 2 year period shall be recorded. The close of the taxable quarter was the relevant sales rate. That's the first thing. Next, we said that the BIR has how many days?
The BIR has 90 days within the 90 days
circulation. Yes, for the submission of supporting documents. Pero yes, hindi nabi nito, dito, so it would appear that the 30 days shall be reckoned from, 90 days shall be reckoned from the filing.
Yes, sir.
From filing, which is March 13. So you count 90 days from March 13, 2019, that is the 30-day period, the 90-day period shall end on?
June 30, 2019, sir.
Ah, mali rin. June 30 kasi merong March 31 at saka May 31. So it should be June 28.
Okay, sir.
90 days, di ba? Pag days, yung specifically days dapat naalala na natin ito sa civil code. So it's the latest, the BIR has until June 28, 2019, which will resolve. During this period, no judicial claim should be filed.
Yes.
Right? Otherwise, this will be a case of premature filing, non-exhaustion of administrative remedies, and the CTA has no jurisdiction.
Yes, sir.
Yes. Once again, but June 20 for the first quarter, filed no March 31, the following day, right? So was it timely filed or prematurely filed?
Prematurely filed.
Yes, prematurely filed, right? How about second quarter?
Likewise, sir. Prematurely filed.
Yes, likewise, prematurely filed. How about the third and fourth quarters?
The same, sir.
Hindi, June 28, di ba? June 28, it was filed. Right? It was filed on time. pero pwede mo sa argue mo sa akin ngayon. Di ba sabi mo kanina, sir, that the train law has not revealed the deep denial. Pero sabi ko naman, as I said, to my mind, pending option, the taxpayers can file an appeal, judicial appeal, within 30 days from the lapse of the 90 days. Can always on. Okay, let's we'll be waiting for a resolution on this. Clarification on this, if the case will be filed, will reach the tax court. Question? Last question, naiintindihan, I think this is the easiest way to explain how to apply Section 112. Rules under Section 112. Question class, this is the best time for you now to clarify if you want to clarify something. Okay, so you give me a thumbs up, please. If this is clear to you, please give me a thumbs up. Okay, next slide, voicing requirements. Section 113 of the tax code enumerates the requirements, voicing requirements. First is a VAT invoice the same with VAT official receipt. The answer is no, right? Section 113 requires that the VAT registered person shall issue a VAT invoice for every sale, barter, or exchange of goods or properties. But if the transaction is a sale of service or lease of property, then the VAT taxpayer should issue a VAT official receipt. And 237 of the tax code, section 237, enumerates the following information that must be indicated in the VAT receipt or VAT invoice. Take note on letter B, if the transaction is a VAT-exempt transaction, the word VAT-exempt should be indicated. Right? Should be indicated in the receipt or invoice. If it's a zero-rated transaction, the word zero-rated must likewise be indicated. Clear. Tapos ng letter C, VAT amount due shall be shown as a separate item. We've already discussed this. The separate indication of VAT of tax method. When we discuss nature and characteristics of VAT system. Now, consequences for issuing erroneous sales invoice or official receipt. What is the effect if a non-VAT registered person issued a VAT receipt pagawa sa rento? Ng VAT receipt, right? Meaning there is a statement that is a VAT registered followed by PIN, kahit hindi siya registered, kahit hindi siya VAT registered taxpayer. But what would be the consequence? The taxpayers liable for percentage tax under Section 116 kasi yun yung binabayaran niya as a non-VAT registered taxpayer. The VAT due on the transaction shall likewise be paid. Even if it's not a valid VAT, but because of erroneously issuing a VAT invoice or receipt, shall be subject to VAT. And of course, the 50% surcharge, right? This is a penalty on the part of the taxpayer for committing a fraudulent act, the 50% surcharge under Section 214B. What is the, how about the buyer of the service or goods? Will he or she or it be entitled to the input tax credit on the purchase, but on the purchase shifted to him? The answer is yes, because he should not be penalized, right? For the committed by the seller of the goods or services. Provided, of course, that this receipt or invoice issued contains all the information as we discussed under Section 237. Clear? Next. What if there is a failure to indicate VAT-exempt sale or VAT-exempt transaction? Invalid siya na VAT-exempt. So, accordingly, it shall be subject to the 12% value. Now, the cases of Eastern, I assigned this one, Eastern Telecom and Euro Philippines. this pertain these two cases, this cast the effect on the failure of a taxpayer to indicate the word zero rated in the VAT receipts or VAT invoice. In Eastern Telecommunication Philippines, which was also reiterated in Northern Mindanao and other several cases, the Supreme Court has consistently held that the failure of the taxpayer to indicate the word zero rated in the VAT receipt or VAT invoice is fatal in the claim for refund. Right? Claim for refund. So, but if there is a refund for unutilized input that arising from zero rated or basically zero rated, but the receipts or invoices does not contain this word zero rated, this will result to the denial of the claim for refund. Clear. But take note of Euro Philippines. Iba naman si Euro Philippines. In that case, there was also a failure to indicate zero. There was also a failure to indicate zero rated in the VAT invoice or receipt. Said that is not fatal to be claimed to the position of Euro Philippines. What's the difference? Who is Euro Philippines? Euro Philippines is an exclusive passenger sales agent of British Airways. Right? British Airways is an offline international carrier engaged in providing services to passengers in the Philippines, but it's an offline. And it provides, and Euro Philippines provides services to British Airways. And Euro Philippines considered this transaction, the provision of services to British Airways as zero rated, being a sale of service to entities engaged in international air transport operation. That is zero rated transaction. We've discussed that, right? Discussed that, zero rated. But the BIR issued a deficiency tax assessment based on this transaction. And it is anchored on the fact that Euro Philippines failed to comply with the invoicing requirement, failed to include the word zero rated on the receipts for the services rendered to British Airways. And this was assailed by Euro Philippines. Protest has been filed, denied by the BIR, then an appeal was filed with the Court of Tax Appeals. So the issue, what is the effect, right, of failure to indicate the word zero rated? Ang position ng BIR, this will result the BIR said that for failure to comply with this invoice requirement, the transaction now is deemed subject to 12% VAT because it's an invalid zero-rated transaction. But the BIR, but the taxpayer maintained that it is exempt under Section 108 because this is a zero-rated transaction under Section 108. How did the court rule? The court said, right, that under there is no provision, or Section 113 does not provide, and even Revenue Regulation 16-2001, does not create a presumption that the non-infringement of the word zero rated shall consider the transaction as transaction subject to the 12%. It still remains to be a zero rated transaction, being a sale of service to international to entities engaged in international air transport operation. Failure to comply with the invoicing requirement as mandated by law does not make the transaction subject to 12%. So it appears that the omission is not fatal, right? Right? So what's the difference? What's the difference? In Eastern, the issue is pay for refund. Right, the issue is claim for refund. The court said that is fatal. But in the case of Euro Philippines, the issue here is not refund, but the case involved deficiency tax assessment. Right, deficiency tax assessment. The court said that is not fatal because the law does not create a presumption that the same shall be the transaction subject to 12%. Question.
Question? Question Bass? Sige, okay lang. Miss, yep. Okay, and that's it for value added tax. Next topic is tax remedies under the tax code. Let's have the break first so that I can prepare the slide. Let's have a 2 minute break. 6:15, we'll assume at 6:17.
ID Xerox daw ng ano, senior citizen ni Mama, kailangan ni chairman, interviewin daw.
Wala. Naririnig ako, class?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Concept of assessment. Tax remedies. Wala na sa Zara. Tax remedies, the provisions under the tax code, relevant tax remedies exist not only to ensure the collection of taxes with the government but also to protect the rights of the taxpayer, right? And we've learned that taxes are the lifeblood of the government. Accordingly, the government should be clothed with authority to devise ways and means in order to ensure the collection of correct taxes. However, on the part of the taxpayer, while taxes are the lifeblood of the government, the collection thereof must be in accordance with rules and regulation. Otherwise, the collection may result to arbitrariness that will result to decay the very reason of the government itself. So it must be a balancing of interests. Therefore, the tax that the BIR should follow rules and regulation relative to the assessment and collection of internal revenue taxes. Okay, the first remedy of the tax of the government is to issue deficiency tax assessment. But I want to emphasize that it is not necessary for the BIR to issue deficiency tax assessment before it can create tax liability. This must be so because taxes are self-assessing. Right? Self-assessing. There is no need for an assessment before it can create tax liability against the taxpayer. However, assessment is not altogether inconsequential. It is relevant to certain cases. Like what? In determination of imposition of surcharge or interest. Right? The government cannot impose surcharge or interest if it cannot issue assessment. What else? In the pursuit of judicial or extrajudicial remedies on the part of the taxpayer. They cannot avail of remedies if there is no assessment issued by the BIR. It is also relevant in the application of the statute of limitations. How can we apply the prescriptive period if there is no assessment issued by the BIR? But I want to emphasize that assessment is not necessary for purposes of creating tax liability. Next, the concept of tax assessment. In the context that it is being used under the tax code, when you say assessment, it is a written notice and demand by the BIR for the settlement of the tax liability that is there definitely set and fixed. That's the pronouncement of the court in the case of Adamson. Now, the more interesting topic, however, is the requisites of a valid assessment. The first requisite is provided for under Section 228. Section 228 expressly provides that an assessment to be valid must be in writing and contains the facts and the law upon which the assessment is based. Very basic yan. Natin yan, Section 228. The court said in the case of Liquigas that the purpose of this written notice of the factual and legal basis is to sufficiently inform the taxpayer of the basis of the assessment so that the taxpayer can intelligently determine or file a protest. Right? Can intelligently file a protest. Let's have an example. Enron Subic Power Corporation. Basan nyo na to. The CIR insisted that there was compliance with Section 228, that the taxpayer was appraised with the factual and legal basis of the assessment. And in support thereof, the CIR claimed that during the pre-assessment stage, the taxpayer, through its representative, was furnished with a preliminary 5-day letter, the first document. What else? Upon request, the taxpayer was also furnished with a copy of the audit working paper used by the revenue officer who conducted the examination or the audit. And allegedly, on this audit working paper, it contains the factual and legal basis of the assessment. So there was an advice, a preliminary letter during the pre-assessment stage, and of course, the audit working paper. So the issue is, was there a valid assessment? Was there compliance with Section 228? The court said no. The law is very clear that an assessment to be valid, there must be a formal letter of demand. Right? There must be a formal letter of demand which must contain the facts and the law upon which the assessment is based. Accordingly, the alleged factual legal basis as provided for under the preliminary letter and the audit working papers and the written advice, these are not sufficient compliance with the requirements of Section 228. Warning, thus the Supreme Court has declared the assessment invalid. Next, United Salvage. United Salvage. In this case, there was a deficiency tax assessment for expanded withholding tax. The same was declared void by the Supreme Court because other than the tabulation of the alleged deficiency tax due, no further details regarding assessment was provided by the CIR. Right? No further details. Only the resulting interest, surcharge, and penalty were anchored with legal basis. Legal basis again. Remember, there must be a factual and legal basis. The court suggested then that the CIR should have at least attached a detailed notice of discrepancy or stated an explanation while the amount of the deficiency tax is due against the taxpayer and how the same was right now. Right? Next, Kilmiko Mauri. What is the issue with Mauri? The question is this. Is there a violation of due process if the CTA invoke a legal basis in its ruling which is different from the legal basis of the assessment issued by the CIR? Right? In the deficiency tax assessment issued by the CIR, the legal basis is Section 34. Right? Section 29, now the Section 34 of the tax code. That's the legal basis of the assessment. When an appeal has been filed with the Court of Tax Appeals, the CTA confirmed the reduced assessment issued by the BIR according to Section 34. Pero dito, ang legal basis ni the Court of Tax Appeals is Section 238. Okay, magkaiba ang legal basis. So, Pilmiko now is claiming that there was omission of due process. There was omission of due process since in the ruling of the CTA, it invoked 238, Section 238, while in the proceedings below, in the protest, as well as the deficiency tax assessment issued by the BIR, the assessment was anchored on Section 34. Magkaiba, right? Magkaiba yung legal basis. Was there a violation of due process? Although the stipulation of facts, and therefore Pilmiko was estopped, right, from claiming that the issue on substantiation requirements of the court is not raw material was not raised therein, so estoppel has been applied. The more important doctrine laid down by the court in relation to facts is this. There was no violation of due process. Right? There was no violation of due process in this case. In a petition for review filed with the Court of Tax Appeals, it is the taxpayer's burden to properly invoke the legal basis. Right? The CTA, on the other hand, is not bound to rely solely on the basis cited by the CIR. Otherwise, the court said two absurd situations may arise. What are these two situations? Affirming the CIR ruling, CIR deficiency tax assessment, or altogether declare the assessment valid if the legal basis of the CIR is misplaced. And this is not the intention of the law. Right? This is not the intention of the law. Accordingly, the CTA may still anchor its ruling on a different legal basis, and this is not a violation of due process. Clear? Clear? Next, Summer One Electric Cooperative. In Summer One, I think nabigay na rin sa bar exam yan. Mag-isa lang dito. Summer One Electric Cooperative. The final assessment issued in this case did not contain the facts of the law upon which the assessment is based. But the Supreme Court ruled that this is fine. Teka muna, di ba sabi natin, dinidiscuss natin Section 238, the assessment must state the facts and the law. But why did the court declare that the assessment is valid? Well, the court declared it valid because of the factual circumstances of this case. What happened? Prior to the conduct of the informal conference, the taxpayer was duly furnished with a copy of the findings of investigation. Right? That's the first document. And these findings of investigation provided for the factual and legal basis of the assessment. Then thereafter, the taxpayer was also given copies of the audit working papers upon its request. Bigay din si BIR. Then thereafter, the submission copies of working papers, pan preliminary assessment notice was issued by the BIR. It contained the details of the deficiency tax assessment. There's a factual and legal basis. The BIR taxpayer filed a protest asserting the validity thereof. A second protest was likewise filed. Si BIR naman has replied to the protest, discussing in details all the legal issues raised by the taxpayer. Diniscuss niya yan. Then thereafter, ang sumunod na document is now the final assessment. As I said, the final assessment notice did not contain the tax bill. Dito na ginawa ng issue ni Samar Alec Juan Ego, cooperative, violation, failure to comply with Section 23. But the Supreme Court said no. There was substantial compliance because of the correspondence and documents between the parties. But I want to emphasize that the Supreme Court has decided that way because of the factual value of the case, because of the correspondences and documents. The general rules still, and the rules still, Section 228, that the assessment must state the facts and the law upon which the same is based. Otherwise, it's policy summary. Clear? Next, second requirement, requisite. An assessment to be valid must... Assessment to be valid must contain a demand by the BIR for a settlement of a tax due liability that is there definitely set and fixed. First case, Pasco Realty. In Pasco Realty, the issue is the affidavit, complaint affidavit for tax evasion filed against the taxpayer with the DOJ. Shall it be treated as an assessment notice, which may be questioned to the Court of Tax Appeals? Right, that's the issue. It was argued that yes, because it contains the computation of the deficiency tax liability. But the Supreme Court said no, the affidavit, while it contains the details of the tax liability, does not ipso facto make it an assessment. The purpose of this assessment notice is to support of this affidavit is to support the case for tax evasion. It is not intended in any way to notify the taxpayer and demand for the payment of the tax. Right? Next, Adamson versus Court of Appeals. In this case, there was an issue on whether or not the CIR's recommendation letter filing for a criminal complaint before the DOJ for tax evasion may be treated as an assessment notice. This recommendation letter also contains the computation of deficiency tax liabilities. But the court said no. Again, the court said that in the context that it is being used in the tax code, assessment is a written demand for the payment. But assessment contains not only the computation of the deficiency tax liability, but also a demand for the payment of a tax due that is there definitely set. Clear. All cases yan. Bagong case. Fitness by design. The assessment notice, final assessment notice, contains the following statement. There's the following statement. Can you see my cursor?
Yes, sir.
I made an emphasis. Highlighting an emphasis on the last sentence, and I quote, please note, however, that the interest and the total amount due will have to be paid or will have to be adjusted if paid prior or beyond April 15, 2004. And the court said, on the basis of this statement, the court said that the fund is not valid. The fund is not valid because it does not contain a demand for the settlement of a tax liability that is their definitely set and fixed. First, reasoning of the court, first, it lacks a definite amount of tax liability for which the respondent is accountable. Take note that it has to be adjusted, right? It's subject to an adjustment for the payment of tax. Second, balance. The assessment notice does not contain a due date for the payment of the tax due. So if there, and this negates demand for payment by the BIR, right? Negates demand payment. How about April 15, 2004? It was argued by the BIR that by the CIR that this is the due date for the payment of the tax due. No, the Supreme Court said that April 15, 2004 is not the due date for the payment, but it is only the opening date for the accrual of penalties and surcharges. Right? Surcharges. Accordingly, the assessment is not valid, for there is no demand for the payment of a tax that is there definitely set and fixed. Clear? Clear? Next. Another requisite. An assessment to be valid must be served on and received by the taxpayer. Due process requires that the assessment notice must be served and received by the taxpayer. It's a very, very basic element of due process. And case of points, the case of estate of Yudel Gabriel versus CIR. What happened in this case? The notice of assessment was served by the BIR to the trust officer or agent of the decedent. Trust officer. Notice of assessment by income tax liability. However, when the BIR served the notice of assessment to the trust or the trust officer or agent of the decedent, Yudel Gabriel was already dead. And you've learned in your civil law, right, that death of either the principal or the agent shall extinguish the agency, right? Right? Such that when the notice was served to the agent, he is no longer the agent of Yudel Gabriel, because the agency has already been extinguished. There was, therefore, an invalid service of assessment notice. Consequently, the assessment is not clear. Citing the case of De La Rama, right? The Public versus De La Rama, the Supreme Court has has clarified that when a state is under administration, notice must be sent to the administrator of the state, since it is the administrator as the representative of the state who has the legal obligation to settle or to discharge all the debts of the estate and perform orders of appointment. Here, I'll clear on this. Next, the fourth requisite. Assessment must be made within the prescriptive period. Within the prescriptive period.
Within the prescriptive
period. And what is the prescriptive period for the issuance of deficiency taxes? The general rule, Section 203. 3 years from the last day prescribed by law for the filing of the return. But if the return is filed beyond the last day prescribed by law for the filing of the return, then the 3 years shall be counted from the filing of the return. Right? Let's have an example. Individual taxpayer for calendar year 2018. The income tax return was filed on March 15, 2019. Individual taxpayer for calendar year 2018, the annual ITR was filed on March 15, 2019. What is the reckoning date for the prescriptive period for the issuance of the deficiency income tax assessment? 3 years from March 15, 2019 or April 15, 2019, because that's the last day prescribed by law for the filing of return. Take note, individual taxpayer can only use calendar year. Di sila pwedeng fiscal year, calendar year, and the due date is on or before 15th of the following year. Pero pag corporate taxpayer and using the fiscal year, ano bang fiscal year again? Any 12-month period ending other than December 31. And the due date for the filing of the annual ITR is on or before 15th of the fourth month following the close of the fiscal period. Right? Pero in the bar exam, the good thing is puro calendar year. Right? Calendar year. Karamihan. Ano? Let's go back to our example. Since the last day prescribed by law is April 15, 2019, so that's the reckoning day of the 3-year period. What if the annual IPR for 2018 was filed by X on April 20? Right? Which is the beyond the last day, right? Last day prescribed by law. What's the reckoning date? The reckoning date in that case is the actual date of filing because it was filed beyond the last day prescribed by law. Clear? Clear. Another scenario. The IPR was filed April 15, 2019. Due date. Right? However, the taxpayer has amended it on June 15, 2019. What's the reckoning date? April 15. Right? The case at point is the case of Phoenix Assurance. What does this case provide? The court said that when the amended return is substantially different from the original return, then the 3-year period shall be reckoned from the filing of the amended return. But if the original return is sufficient enough, order for the BIR to determine the correct internal revenue tax, then the reckoning date of the 3-year period shall be from the filing of the original return. Clear? And in this case, sabi ni court, there was the original return, the amended return is substantially different from the original return because the amendment covers alterations on allowable deductions. Exclusions of insurance premiums, various items deductions, which substantially modifies the original return. Accordingly, the reckoning date shall be from the filing of the amended return. Clear? Clear. Next. 2019 dito. Dr. De La Isabela.
Holding tax assessments are covered by a prescriptive period under withholding tax assessments such as
yes, the floor, the lights are there. What happened in this case? The CIR issued tax assessment for withholding tax on compensation and expanded withholding tax. Withholding tax on compensation and expanded withholding tax, but the same was made beyond the 3-year prescriptive period. Several waivers were executed, but they were all defective. Accordingly, the 3-year prescriptive period was not extended by these waivers. But so, nagpapalusot si BIR. Anong nagpapalusot ni BIR? The BIR has forwarded a novel jury that under section 203 involving the 3-year prescriptive period is not applicable in cases of assessment for withholding tax on compensation and expanded withholding tax. Ito applicable to section 203. The BIR reasoned out that these withholding taxes are not internal revenue taxes. They are not internal revenue taxes, but they are penalties imposed against the withholding agent for failure to comply with their duties as a withholding agent. Failure to collect and remit the withholding tax. So section 203, sabi ni BIR, is not applicable. What is applicable? Walang provision sa tax code, therefore we apply the provisions under the civil law. What is the argument of the BIR then? The concept of withholding tax assessments are covered by the prescriptive period under Section 203. The assessments for expanded withholding tax and withholding tax on compensation are deficient internal revenue taxes. The aim is not merely to impose a penalty for failure to withhold on the part of the taxpayer, but also to collect unpaid income taxes. So, 203 shall be applicable even to assessments involving withholding tax. Clear? Clear? Sections, the 3-year prescriptive period. Section 203. Section 222 provides for the exemptions on the 3-year prescriptive period. Number one, in case of false return, fraudulent return with intent to evade tax, and failure to file return. The prescriptive period in these cases is 3 years reckoned from the discovery of the falsity, fraud, or omission. Right? Falsity of false return, fraud of fraudulent return, and omission in case of failure to file return. I want to emphasize that under this provision, Section 222A, we have three different cases. Kaya naka-ABC nga. Right? False return, fraudulent return with intent to evade tax, and failure to file return. Here, next issue. Is a false return the same with fraudulent return? Sabi natin, hindi, magkaiba. Right? Magkaiba. But in case of false return, is it necessary to establish intent to evade tax? Let's go back to the previous slide. False return, fraudulent return with intent to evade tax. Very clear. But with respect to false return, is it necessary to establish intent to evade tax? First case, that's not. Si Ms. Sudara, sabi niya. Let's try to discuss the cases, relevant cases. ASNAR. In ASNAR, the Supreme Court has made a definition of a false return and a fraudulent return. False return, it implies deviation from truth, whether intentional or not. Kapag ang aking gross income ay 3 million, pero ang dineclare ko lang ay... Sorry, kung aking gross income ay 30 million, ang dineclare ko lang ay 29,999,000, is it a false return? Yes, it's a deviation from truth. Right? Deviation from truth, following the definition of false return. But when you say fraudulent return, it implies intentional or deceitful entry with intent to evade taxes. After ASNAR, we have the case of P.F. Goodrich. In the case of P.F. Goodrich, the CIR insisted that the taxpayer has committed falsity. What was the basis of this falsity? When the taxpayer sold a property less than the fair market value. The basis of CIR. But the court said, no, this fact alone did not constitute a false return which contains wrong information due to mistake, carelessness, or ignorance. So this is not constitute false return that would warrant the application of the 10-year prescriptive period. It is possible that a real property may be sold for less than fair market value for a bona fide business purposes, for as long as the transaction remains outstanding. Thus, that this would not warrant the application of the 10-year prescriptive period. After the P.F. Goodrich, Summer One Electric Cooperative, adopting the case of ASNAR, the court said that there was a substantial under-declaration of withholding tax, and this constituted falsity. How much is the under-declaration? 2.6 million. It constituted falsity in the subject return by the taxpayer, warranting the application of the 10-year prescriptive period and not the 3-year prescriptive period under Section 2.3. Now, lately, meron si Asalus. In determining whether or not to apply, in determining whether or not the tax return is a false return that would warrant the application of the 10-year prescriptive period. In this case, the Supreme Court has applied Section 248B. Ano yung Section 248B? It provides for a prima facie evidence of a false or fraudulent return. Right? What's this prima facie evidence? If there is a substantial under-declaration of taxable sales, exits or income or substantial overstatement, over-declaration of allowable deductions expenses, shall be prima facie of a false or fraudulent return. And when you say substantial, it means the under-declaration or overstatement exceeded the 30%. Right? That's the prima facie evidence under Section 2. And in this case, in other words, if there is a showing that there was a substantial under-declaration of gross sales, tax on income, and over-declaration of expenses allowable deduction. This is a prima facie evidence of a false approved return, and the applicable period now is 10-year prescriptive period and not 3 years. And in this case, the audit investigation in assets revealed that there were under-declared patable goods by more than 30%. Not all membership fees, particularly those pertaining to medical practitioners, were reported in the PAT report. So the court said that the applicable period, the prescriptive period, is 10 years. Because the returns are false. Few months thereafter, after the ASALUS, tumabas si EDI. Following month, actually following month. In relation to false return, in the case of PDI, the court has came up with the principle of intentional falsity. Intentional falsity. So with respect to false return, we have to determine whether the falsity is intentional or not. Right? Intentional or not. When the falsity is intentional, then this would warrant the application of the 10-year prescriptive period because the return is false, right? But if following the, but adapting the case of Bert Goodrich, the court said that if the falsity is not intentional, meaning it is an entry of wrong information due to mistake, carelessness, or ignorance without intent to evade tax, then this does not constitute. Right? This does not constitute falsity. And what happened in this case? The court noted that there were discrepancies.
The court shall.
The court, what happened in this case? The court noted that there were discrepancies in the tax returns of PDI as stated in the letter notice. In letter notice, this is the information based on third-party sources. But was able to explain the discrepancies, which was the basis of the alleged falsity of the BIR, but PDI was able to explain. Particularly, PDI explained that there was an erroneous posting of data and erroneous listing of purchases as general and administrative expenses, which remains unresolved. So accordingly, the falsity in the tax returns of PDI was a result of an error. So it's not intentional, right? So it's not an intentional falsity. Thus, the prescriptive period applicable is 3 years and not 10 years. How about the fraud? The Supreme Court said that the BIR was not able to establish that the taxpayer has filed a fraudulent return with intent to defraud. Clear? Are we clear on this? So, tatandaan, ASALUS, BIR, and Bien Goodrich. Ang magandang insulat sa tax sa booklet, ito. Right? Booklet. Entry of wrong information due to mistake, carelessness, or ignorance does not constitute false. Question? Question plus? Next. Another exemption to the 3-year prescriptive period. Letter B, waiver of the statute of limitations. Waiver of the statute of limitations. This is an agreement entered into between the taxpayer and the government to extend the period to assess to a period certain. Right? An agreement. And therefore, this is not a unilateral act on the part of the taxpayer because it's an agreement between the government and the taxpayer. And I want to state at this point that the rules on the execution of the waiver of the statute of limitations and shall likewise be applied in cases of prescriptive period for the collection, right? Collection of internal revenue taxes. Does not apply only to period to assess, but also in the period to collect the number of taxes. Another nature of the waiver of the statute of limitations is its derogation of the taxpayer's right to security against prolonged and unscrupulous investigation by the BIR. Accordingly, rules in the execution of a valid waiver must be strictly complied. Right? Must be strictly complied. Next, the execution of waiver is not the waiver to invoke the defense of prescription. What does this mean? If the BIR, the taxpayer, has executed the waiver, it can still later on assail the validity of the waiver on the ground of a prescription. In several cases, one of which, ito si Stanley, the BIR, ito si yung argument ng CIR. The CIR argued that the act of executing a waiver, right, the taxpayer now is stopped from assailing the validity and raising the defense of prescription. But that's not tenable according to the Supreme Court, because the execution of a waiver is not a right to invoke the defense of prescription. Clear? Okay. Now, very interestingly, in relation to waiver, we have this doctrine of estoppel.
Mm-hmm.
What is this? I've discussed, right? The taxpayer is not stopped from raising the defense of prescription, the fact that it has executed a waiver. And in fact, this is the general rule, right? The rule declared by the court in several cases, one of which is Kudos Metal. The doctrine of estoppel cannot be applied as an exception to the statute of limitations, considering that there is a detailed procedure for the proper execution of a waiver, which must be strictly followed by the BIR. In relation, however, to this, take note of RCBC.
The documents that I can
see. Sino si RCBC? Nabigay na rin si Abar exam. Ito. RCBC executed two waivers, extending the period to assess internal revenue taxes. Then after, RCBC received final assessment notice. The assessment notice was issued beyond the 3-year prescriptive period, but within the extended period as contained in the waiver. Right? Then after it received the fund, it filed the protest and submitted relevant supporting documents. As a result of the investigation of the protest, RCBC received another fund. And this fund, the another fund, drastically reduced the original amount of deficiency tax assessment. Right? Reduced yung assessment, therefore RCBC paid the deficiency taxes except for onshore tax and documentary stamp tax, which were now the subjects of the appeal before the Court of Tax Appeals. Right? Did you get that last? Now, before the Court of Tax Appeals, eto na. Siyempre, si taxpayer has invoked prescription. Right? Prescription. The assessment has already prescribed. Pero si BIR has presented waivers. There were waivers extending the period. Taxpayer argued, countered that the waivers were defective. There is no issue, or there's no doubt that the waivers were defective for failure to comply with the requirements of RMO 20-9. So, defective, yeah. The same were not signed or confirmed by the taxpayer, by the CIR, which is required under Section 222 of the tax. However, the court said that there was a estoppel, right, on the part of RCBC. Right? RCBC. And what's this estoppel? The partial payment of the revised assessment issued within the extended period. This partial payment is an implied admission that the waivers are valid. Had the taxpayer truly believed that the waivers were invalid, then the assessment, which were issued beyond the 3-year prescriptive period, should not have been paid in the first place by the court. But since there was a partial payment, wait na, stop ka na. Did you get that? So that's the waiver. That was already given to Balsa. 2017. systems, technology. Ganun din, there were waivers were executed and the waivers were all invalid. Plus, tingnan nyo, yung sa factual circumstances involving cases ng waivers, pare-parehas. Ano yung pare-parehas? Si BIR mag-i-issue ng deficiency tax assessment beyond the 3-year prescriptive period. Right? Yeah. Tapos sasabihin ni taxpayer, void kasi prescribed na. Maglalabas si BIR ng waiver. Then may waiver ka and we extended the period, right? Period. Tapos ka-counter din si taxpayer claiming that the waiver is invalid because it did not comply with the requirements of the law and therefore, it did not extend the 3-year prescriptive period. Yan. Puro ganun lang parate. And the issue in, and the issue now is the validity of the waiver. So system technology. Waivers were executed, they were all invalid, no doubt, non-compliance with the requirement of the law. Therefore, it did not extend the period. However, in this case, the CIR invoked RCBC. Right? And the RCBC, that there was a stopper in RCBC, right? So the partial payment during the extended period is an implied conclusion of the validity of the waivers. The CIR claimed that systems technology has participated in the administrative investigation by filing a request for investigation. Nag-participate siya. And as a result, there was a reduction of the original assessment. Right? There was a reduction of the assessment. That's the claim of the CIR. That's the basic, the alleged basis of the assessment. But the court said, no. The estoppel in STI is anchored not only on the reinvestigation, but also on the partial payment. Right? There was partial payment during the extended period.
Mm-hmm.
The estoppel upheld in RCBC arose from the taxpayer's act of payment and not on the reduction in the amount of the assessment. So accordingly, estoppel shall apply in this case. Clear? Next, 2018, Avon. Basahing maigi si Avon, Justice Leonel case, there were several issues. There were several issues in Avon.
Kaya pala wala na si Avon.
Discuss first the issue on waivers. Okay. Avon naman, in this case, two waivers were supposedly executed, extending the original 3-year prescriptive period for the assessment. The waivers, however, were invalid again for failure to comply with the requirements under RMO 20-19. The CIR, however, contended that there was an estoppel. Right? And Avon is estopped from assailing the validity of the waiver because it made partial payments on the disputed assessments. The BIR has invoked the case of RCBC. The court said that RCBC is not applicable. Why? They thought even there was partial payment after the reinvestigation. The court said that the estoppel upheld in RCBC arose from two points. Right? Number one, the benefit obtained by the taxpayer, and that benefit is what? Reduction, drastic reduction of the deficiency tax assessment. And second, partial payment. Right? Partial payment. In this case, totoo, there was partial payment. But was there a benefit? Was there a reduction? The court said no. As in fact, tumaas nga. Tumaas pa nga yung assessment after the protest. Right? Avon did not receive any benefit from the waivers. On the contrary, there was a drastic increase. Right? So the way that the estoppel in the case of RCBC, the basis, right, of estoppel were not present in this case. Clear? Are we clear on this? So tatandaan, 2017, 2018, di pa lumalabas sa bar exam. Si RCBC, there was partial payment after reinvestigation. The court said, and there was reduction. The estoppel. Avon, there was partial payment, but there was no benefit because there was no reduction. On the contrary, there was a drastic increase in the deficiency tax. Clear? Clear? Right. Next.
Okay.
Next mobile, 2015. Next mobile, pinahirapan kami dyan sa Manila. And I was with the BIR. But this case, this is not my case. Yung taxable year na iba yung amin. Next mobile, CIR versus next mobile. The doctrine of estoppel was recognized because of the peculiarities in this case. How many waivers were executed? 5 waivers.
Huh?
Right? 5 waivers. Yung 3-year period is about to lapse, nag-execute ng waiver. When the period, as stated in the first waiver, is about to lapse, another waiver was executed.
So
and so on and so forth, hanggang nakalima. Surprisingly, all the waivers were invalid. Failure to comply with regulations. RMO 20-. So when you know, hindi na nagkasundo, when it reached now the Board of Tax Appeals, ginawa na ni ExMobile, it invoked now the invalidity of the waivers. So prescribed na daw. Of course, this Board of Tax Appeals has applied the rule that all the requisites for the execution of a valid waiver under regulations of the BIR must be strictly followed. So according, waivers were invalid, it did not extend the period, and therefore the assessment has already prescribed. But the court, when it reached the Supreme Court, doctrine of estoppel has been applied, right, because of peculiarities, as I said. The waivers were upheld when both the taxpayers and the BIR went to validate them. Both parties are at fault. The taxpayer's act of impugning the waiver after benefiting from them was considered bad faith on the part of the taxpayer. Accordingly, the more appropriate, right, resolution of the case is the application of estoppel in order to prevent undue injury on the part of the drug government because of the cancellation of the assessment. So waiver. Tapos, marami na yan. Sunod-sunod na. After next mobile, marami na rin sa tax court. And lately, nagkaroon Asian transmission that reached the Supreme Court. Dito naman, malala, 8 waivers.
Right?
8 waivers. Ganun din. All invalid. Failure to comply with RMO 12-19. But notwithstanding the infirmities or ALVA, the court has sustained the validity following the pronouncement in the case of next mobile. Each of the taxpayer because the waivers would provide the taxpayer sufficient time to gather and produce records for the audit. Accordingly, it would be unfair when APC should be permitted to assail the waivers only after the assessment proved to be adverse. So this was so take note of the factual circumstances in these two cases. Ayun, ang tanong, paano pag 4 waivers lang? Pag 6 waivers, okay, nandiyan na si next mobile. 5 waivers. Paano pag 4 waivers lang? Paano pag 3 waivers
lang? RCBC.
So you know, these two cases, it depends on how you argue. Right? Depends on how you argue. And I laid down the legal, the jurisprudence that may be used as your legal basis for all of this. Okay? Next. Then, yung ito, I will not discuss this case anymore. Ibigay ko sa more example. Ay, sa finance. Did I assign this, Mr. Biddle, transition? Yes, I think I assigned that.
Yes, sir.
Yes, well, I'm asking this. Next, requisites of invalid waiver. For all the cases I have assigned, the court has applied RMO 20-19 and RDAO 0501. These regulations provide for the requisites of the execution of valid waiver. And the court said that it must be strictly followed. Meron pang number ng copies. Meron pang requirements on the distribution of the copies. Meron pang statement as requirement as to the dates that should be appearing in the copy of the waiver. There is a template. Pero surprisingly, that for all the cases, di ba puro talo si BIR? Puro talo, puro ba yung banit na lahat ng waivers? I don't know the reason. I don't know if it was intentionally done or intentionally. But the court said, the RMO 20-90 must be strictly followed. Yan yung sinasabi. And, I don't know, there is, based on this regulation, there is provision there in stating that revenue, the responsible revenue officers of the BIR in the invalidity of the waivers shall be held administratively liable. Hindi ko alam kung meron nang napapanish na. So accordingly, because of these eventualities, puro talo si BIR, Kodos Mental, FNM, of Korean, Pas Korean, dami puro talo lang. Because of the stringent requirements under RFO, the BIR, right, now decided now to limit the requisites of execution of a valid waiver. Accordingly, in 2016, the BIR came out with this RMO 14-2016, amending RMO 20-90 and R-0501. Pinasimple lang. And under this regulation, the waiver, right, may be but not necessarily in the form prescribed under RMO 20-90 kasi merong attachment doon, merong template. Maybe, but not necessarily in the particular form for as long as the following requisites are present. Tatlo na lang. And what are these? The period that has already lapsed. So prior to lapse, must be extended. Second, the waiver must be signed by the taxpayer himself, or if the waiver before was executed merely by the accountant, by the finance manager, without the appropriate authority, that is not a valid waiver. But under RMO 14-2016, may be signed by the taxpayer or is duly authorized representative. May be authorized representative. In case of a corporation, the waiver must be signed by any of its responsible officials. Yan. Any responsible officials. And of course, third one is the expiry date of the period agreed upon must be indicated in the waiver. So, an indefinite waiver is not allowed. Right? It's not allowed. But the period must be indicated. Clear. Are we clear on this? Question, waivers? Question, waivers. Lana, next. When is an assessment deed made? Let's have an example. The taxable year is 2016. The taxpayer is using calendar year period. The IUPR was filed on April 15 of 2017, which is 15th day of April of the year. The BIR, we said earlier that the 3-year period shall be reckoned from April 15, 2017, right? For the deficiency income tax assessment. The BIR issued the assessment, mailed the assessment, mailing, on April 15, 2020. Right? April 15, 2020, which is within the 3-year prescriptive period, yes, right? Tama, yan. 3 years from April 15, 2017 is April 15, 2020. So, the mailing was within the 3-year period. However, the assessment notice was received only 10 days thereafter. It was only received by the taxpayer on April 25, 2020. Question, is the assessment valid? Was the assessment made within the 3-year prescriptive period? That's the issue. Barcelona Rojas versus CIR, the court said that the assessment is deemed when the notice was released, mailed, or sent by the CIR to the taxpayer within the prescriptive period. Even if the capital off was received after the 3-year prescriptive period, for as long as the mailing, releasing, or sending was made within the 3-year prescriptive period. Clear? Clear. But again, due process requires that the assessment notice must be received, must be actually received because of the case of due to the ground clear, right? It's an element of due process. Due process requires that the assessment notice must be served on and received by the taxpayer. So as long as the release is effected before prescription set in, assessment is still made on time, even so the same is actually received by the taxpayer after the expiration of the period. Clear? Are we clear on this? Next. Running of suspension of the running of the statute of limitations. Section 223 of the tax code enumerates the instances where the running of the running of the prescriptive period for the assessment and collection. Again, 223 applies also to the period to collect and assess. Right? Under these enumerations, the period shall be suspended. For one, for the period where the CIR is prohibited from making an assessment or beginning the strength or levy or proceeding in court for 60 days thereafter. Right? For 60 days thereafter. The perfect example of this is the case of Protector Service versus Court of Appeals. The court said that the pendency of a taxpayer's appeal with the Court of Tax Appeals in the Supreme Court legally prevented the CIR from collecting the internal revenue tax. So the period to collect has been suspended. And in 2012, last year, the BIR issued RMC 40-34/2020. And this was also amended, right? And under this regulation states that the running of the statute of limitations is suspended during the national emergency due to COVID-19 pandemic. This is pursuant to the provisions of the BAO. The BAO, Umian to Ilas Man Act. So this during the national emergency, the period to collect and to assess is suspended pursuant to number one of section. Accordingly, the prescriptive period shall resume to run after 60 days from the lifting of the national emergency. Clear? Here? Next. Second, when the taxpayer requests for an investigation which is granted by the CIR. There are two things that I want you to remember under this provision. For one, it is a request for investigation and not reconsideration that suspends the running of the prescriptive period. Right? And what is the difference between rein and revoke? Yes. When you say request for investigation, there is a plea for the reevaluation of the assessment on the basis of the newly discovered evidence. That's reinvestigation. About recon, the plea for the reevaluation of the assessment is on the basis of existing documents. Right. Clear? Are we clear on this? Now, what's the second thing that I want you to remember? For the request for investigation to suspend the running of the prescriptive period, it must be granted by the CIR. Right? It must be granted by the CIR. That's the pronouncement of the court in the case of BPI versus CIR. Third, when the taxpayer cannot be located in the address as indicated in the tax return unless there is a notice of change of address. Part 1, when warrant of distrait or levy is due to serve and no property duplicated, of course, when the taxpayer is outside the Philippines. In relation to number 3, when the taxpayer cannot be located in the address unless there is a notice of change of address, take note of the case of BASF. The taxpayer in this case, BASF, moved out from its address in Las Piñas City and transferred in Laguna. the BIR issued the deficiency tax assessment through mailing in the taxpayer's address in Las Piñas City. Doon nila pinadala. Taxpayer, of course, asserted the validity of assessment in invoking due process because it was not duly served. And of course, prescription was stated. Prescription, the 3-year prescriptive period to assess has already lapsed. The BIO claimed that the period to suspend, the period to assess was suspended because there was a change of address. Right? Because the taxpayer cannot be located in the address in the IPR. Right? The address in the IPR. And the taxpayer did not comply with the requirements of the regulation that there must be a formal application for the change of address. No application for change, no update of information has been filed for the change of address. So according to the BIR, the period to assess was suspended. Was suspended. The issue was the period to assess suspended. The court noted, however, that the BIR was aware, even if there was no formal filing of a change of address, no update of information. The facts of the case show that the BIR was aware of the new address in Laguna. In fact, the court said that there were notices. There were documents, letters sent by the taxpayer to the BIR, the notice of dissolution, indicating that the new address now is in Laguna. At saka ito yung nakakatuwa. The BIR who conducted the investigation, the audit, also went to the office in, to the new address in Laguna. So the BIR, by all indication, is aware of the new address, despite the absence of the formal written notice of change of address. Accordingly, the running of the 3-year prescriptive period was not suspended. Right? Nakita doon sa BIR records sent to the taxpayer. I sent to the Court of Tax Appeals. The BIR became aware of the new address in Laguna. Clear? Clear? Question? Yes. Question?
Yes, sir. Question.
Yes.
Sir, yung sa issue ng service of assessment notice.
Yes.
Ang practice kasi iniiwan lang, sir, sa mga gwardiya. Compliance na ho ba yun o
existing rule na hindi? Magandang strategy yan. Ganito, the settled jurisprudence is if, let's go first to the meaning, if assessment notice is served through registered mail, there's a presumption of receipt in the course, in the ordinary course of mailing, right? There's a presumption.
Yes, sir.
In your evidence, through support, right? But if the taxpayer denied the receipt of the assessment notice, the burden is shifted to the BIR. It's the burden of the BIR to prove actual receipt. Right? Actual receipt. That's the consistent resolution of the court. Kaya nga, sabi ko nga, if I am drafting protest, maraming kong denial ng parating. Denial. Imagine 3 years na mag-ano yan eh. Before 3 years, more than 2 years bago magpo-protest, mag-issue ng assessment si BIR. And if the assessment notice was served through mailing, walang ebidensya si BIR. Kasi lalo na pag hindi sila kumuha ng certification from the post office. And under post office regulation, I think after 2 years, nini-dispose ng that. Reports. So, denial. Okay. Second, yung sinasabi mo, if it's received by a security guard, The question there here is the security guard authorized to receive for on behalf of the taxpayer? That's my question. Is that security guard? Pag individual taxpayer court, pati mga RTC and even fiscalis kung saan, cases sa kanila, sabi nila, it's not a valid service. Individual, lalo na pag individual taxpayer. Pag if it's a corporate taxpayer, of course, you have to establish, on the part of the BIR, they have to establish based on factors that the person who received is authorized to receive on behalf of corporate. So, dun sa question mo, if I'm for the government, of course, I will establish facts that the security guard is authorized to receive on behalf. Pero pag sa ano naman, on the part of taxpayer, I would insist na hindi. Right? That's why yung BIR na ngayon, kung minsan, although, based on RR 18-2013, the priority mode is, of course, is through personal service of assessment notices. And there are substituted service provided for on this regulation. But again, service by way of mail is still valid. Clear?
Sir, last question. Dahil ang substituted service naman po ay valid service ng assessment notice, susundin siya, may one question na ganyan dito sa next part. Susundin pa rin namin, sir, yung new rules of civil procedure na kailangan three attempts on two separate days gagawin, sir, ng tax agent o hindi na. Pagkakasir yung taxpayer, ibabagsak na lang niya kung kami yung authorize.
So the regulation, RR 18-2013, does not mention of the requirement.
Okay, sir. So ibig sabihin, sir, kapag pumunta po yung tax agent, wala yung taxpayer, hahanap na lang siya ng clerk is not na presumed authorized. Pwede na niyang iwanan, sir.
That is also a substituted service. Under RR 18.
Thank you, sir.
Question at this point? Next. Is assessment necessary before prosecution? That's the next topic. Okay, mabibigit tayo. It's already 7:26. We'll continue from their next meeting. Assignment for next meeting is assessment necessary before prosecution up to collection. Collection of taxes.